The plasmoid at the center of a galaxy 300 million light years away has astronomers stumped. Its behavior is perplexing to space scientists for exactly one reason. They simply do not recognize that it exists. For many decades, the space sciences have accepted that at the center of most galaxies is a supermassive black hole, a hypothetical object which is believed to be billions of times more dense than our sun, and whose gravitational field is so intense that nothing, not even light, can escape. However, as members of the electric universe and plasma cosmology communities have always known, an experimentally and observationally supported theoretical alternative to the black hole does exist, which does not involve what our good friend, mathematician Stephen Crothers, cheekily describes as mathemagics, but only real-world physics, or more precisely, plasma physics. It is the physics of the plasmoid, with well over half a century of experimental research, that makes the stupendous energies and mass at the center of a galaxy explicable. What is a plasmoid? The term was coined by the renowned MIT physicist Winston H. Bostick to describe a concentration of electromagnetic energy caused by electric currents. At the centers of galaxies, where astronomers believe they see a supermassive black hole, the plasmoid concentrates and stores energy, and is connected to a larger galactic electrical circuitry. When the plasmoid reaches a threshold density, it discharges, usually along a galaxy spin axis. This is the source of stupendous galactic jets. Indeed, the unfathomably powerful electric currents in said jets is not a matter of controversy. However, nothing electrical is thought to cause anything in the cosmos. Therefore, when astrophysicists see the undeniable fingerprint of electrical discharge, particularly at a cosmological scale, the result is the conception of exceptionally weird gravitational and magnetic processes. Often, we hear that the mechanisms behind such processes are, quote, not well understood, or remain mysterious. Other times, they are readily acknowledged as, quote, baffling, since the energies and dynamics of what is actually observed are completely incompatible with gravity-centric modeling. After decades of exploring these questions, I've come to recognize this kind of language as an indirect confession of the incredible exclusion of any causative role of electromagnetism in astronomy. I don't think this has ever been more clear than in recent reports on the, quote, wild behavior of a hypothetical black hole just a few hundred million light years away. Since 2019, scientists have been observing what they interpret as, quote, eruptions from a previously quiescent black hole. Said eruptions, of course, are more accurately characterized as electrical discharge. However, in this case, they are exponentially more powerful than the prevailing theory predicted or can explain. A new Science Alert article describes the observations as follows. A supermassive black hole 300 million light years away has astrophysicists stumped. It lurks at the center of a galaxy, which, since 2019, researchers have been watching in real time as it awoke from a quiescent slumber and started blazing with activity, belching out a series of eruptions of light. This in itself is consistent with how we know supermassive black holes to behave. But the behavior of this particular black hole, nicknamed Antsky, is so weird and wild that it's challenging to explain. Astrophysicist Joheen Chakraborty of MIT stated, "The bursts of X-rays from Antsky are 10 times longer and 10 times more luminous than what we see from a typical quasi-periodic eruption. Each of these eruptions is releasing 100 times more energy than we have seen elsewhere. Antsky's eruptions also show the longest cadence ever observed, of about 4.5 days. This pushes our models to their limits and challenges our existing ideas about how these X-ray flashes are being generated." Now folks, it was 13 years ago that I created the video series, Space News from the Electric Universe. And after producing more than 500 videos on these topics, I cannot count the number of times I've discussed astrophysical data which shatters common beliefs, precisely because of the phenomena's undeniable electromagnetic nature. A clue to the taproot of this disconnect between theory and observation can be found in the previously quoted statement, how we know supermassive black holes to behave. I can't overstate the disservice that I think is being done to the general public when scientists and science journalists choose to misrepresent popular theories as science fact. Unfortunately, however, this is virtually always how science media presents science theory. the more popular the theory, the less likely science journalists are to meet the absolute minimum requirements of due diligence. I ordinarily refrain from the kind of declarative statement that I made at the outset of this video, when I asserted that the quote, weird and wild object called Anski is not a black hole, but rather a plasmoid. As always, the viewer is free to reject the assertion if you feel it's not valid. But I think it's well past time that the highly evidential concepts of the EU and plasma cosmology become normalized, rather than continue to be misrepresented as fringe or pseudoscientific. The general public, and for that matter, students of astronomy and astrophysics at universities around the world, have little to no familiarity with plasma physics. I honestly don't know how many have never even heard of a plasmoid. Therefore, unsurprisingly, when news media were flooded years ago with the so-called first image of a black hole, no one bothered to note that said image, if one takes it at face value, reveals exactly the donut-shaped structure expected of a plasmoid. Now, in this kind of video presentation, I can only reference a fraction of previous black hole discoveries I've discussed here. This includes the observation of star formation happening much too close to the hypothetical black hole at Sagittarius A in our own Milky Way galaxy, where tidal forces should be much too great for stars to form. And it includes the repudiation of astronomers' expectation that a gas cloud called G2 would be violently consumed as it, quote, collided with said hypothetical black hole. I think what I'd like to highlight instead is a discovery which, like many others both previous and subsequent, should have already been more than sufficient to catalyze the inevitable theoretical shift from gravity-centric cosmology to plasma physics in the space sciences. In 2020, I reported on an unprecedented and, quote, mind-boggling event around a so-called black hole, which was so rapid, energetic, and completely unexpected to astronomers, it shook the very bedrock of black hole theory. In 2018, an effort began to scan the sky for supernovae, called the All-Sky Automated Survey for Supernovae, and it detected a surprising, sudden leap in the brightness of an active galactic nucleus, to about 40 times its normal luminosity. This dramatic increase in brightness inspired a team of scientists to keep their eye on the object. To their astonishment, over a period of less than 1 year after the initial outburst, the so-called black hole corona's brightness then dropped by a factor of 10,000 over less than 1 year. A co-author of a paper on the discovery stated, "We expect that luminosity changes this big should vary on timescales of many thousands to millions of years. But in this object, we saw it change by 10,000 over a year, and it even changed by a factor of 100 in 8 hours, which is just totally unheard of and really mind-boggling. In fact, the conundrum of cosmological entities such as galaxies, quasars, and stars experiencing seemingly impossibly rapid evolutionary changes is increasingly common. This includes quiet galaxies that have suddenly transformed into blazing quasars in the span of just hundreds of days. And astronomers have been just as astonished to see quasars, quote, turning off in an equally impossibly short time span. As noted in a 2016 New Scientist report, astronomers expect quasars to use up their fuel and settle down into quiet galaxies, a process that should take hundreds of thousands of years. So last year, when a dozen quasars were spotted shutting down in just hundreds of days, it was a shock. What's more, one quasar appeared to turn on several years after turning off. The real surprise is the time scale. Previously, astronomers thought it should take thousands to millions of years to funnel enough gas onto a supermassive black hole for it to spawn a quasar. It definitely shouldn't take less than 10. Eric Morgenson of Harvard University stated, "This is a bit of an embarrassing moment for black hole and quasar scientists. The conventional wisdom was found to be dramatically wrong." Now, of course, as everyone in the EU and plasma cosmology communities is well aware, the electromagnetic force is 10 to the 39th power stronger than gravity. And the proposed timescales of the formation of objects such as galaxies, stars, and quasars is of course vastly more rapid than in standard theory. I recommend that viewers examine the Gareth Samuel presentation, From Experiment to Quasar, Unveiling Lerner's Plasmoid Model, which is available on Gareth's YouTube channel, See the Pattern. In this presentation, as well as many others that Gareth has produced on the plasmoid in cosmology, we see visceral demonstrations of the laboratory experiments which stunningly recreate many of the most spectacular astrophysical phenomena, including light-years-long galactic jets and stupendous X-ray emissions, which astronomers attribute to black holes. As longtime viewers know, laboratory research has illuminated the electromagnetic mechanisms behind both star and galaxy formation. The filaments of constant and near-constant width along which stars form are the clearest evidence of the electrical circuitry at the heart of astrophysical processes. Quasars, quote, turning on and off for no readily apparent reason may be, quote, embarrassing for black hole and quasar scientists, but to plasma scientists, it is surely another observational reminder that electromagnetism and not gravity is the fundamental organizing force in the universe. In conclusion, on a personal note, in a couple of months, I'll be celebrating my 50th birthday. Now, I've always lived a lifestyle focused on health and fitness, which is geared toward longevity, but I honestly don't know if I'll live to see the day when the logical, experimentally and observationally supported theses of plasma cosmology and the electric universe finally receive a figurative seat at the table of cosmology. For the sake of the sciences, the educational systems, our human culture, and our species' future happiness and success, let's hope another half century of delay proves unnecessary. Thank you.